going for a hockey puck to start with. You can tell when the clay is centered because when I first started, my hands were moving around with the clay. When this clay is centered, my hands are holding the clay and they're not moving. They're perfectly still. That's centered enough. So the next thing we do is make a donut. That's how I teach the kids. So you're basically just drilling down in the center and pulling out a little bit to make like a donut. When you're first learning, it's hard to judge how far down you are. And even if you're making a different kind of form that you're not used to making, you can tell the thickness using a needle tool. Just push it all the way down to the bottom, pull it up, and that's how to leave the bottoms. So you know if you want to go thinner or leave it as it is. You have to make sure that you compress the bottom very well. You don't want to let water sit in the bottom. It's a little tricky to get the hang of having the clay wet enough, but not too wet. If the clay dries out, you stick to your fingers and it'll tear right away. So now what I'm doing is I'm pulling up the sides. And if you notice, I always brace my hands. I try to keep myself very steady. If you want the clay to come out this way, you have your outside hand on the bottom and your inside hand on the top. As you pull the clay up, it pulls out. If you want the clay to go in, you do the reverse, where your outside hand is on the top and your inside hand is below. You can also collar in the clay like this. Potters actually purposefully make their rims a little uneven so that it feels more natural and more handmade. I generally try to get mine fairly straight and then wiggle them up afterwards. Potters like to use a lot of tools. And a lot of them are very simple tools. We use a lot of ribs. Some of the ribs are wooden, some of them are plastic. Some of my favorite ribs are actually made out of old credit cards. They make great ribs. This is one of my favorites. This is good for making a wood.
This one to say that it's a process. be as careful with that as pottery, but still, you know, it's still mold.
You, one of the things that I love a lot about working on the wheel is that it's very non-cerebral. Your hands learn to play. And basically, you just have to keep your ego, your mind, out of the way.
Okay.
And so it's a lot of experimentation, and depending on the type of clay that you use, how hard or soft it is, how much rod or tooth it has to it, that will depend on how much you can stretch it, right? So you learn your clay, and you learn the limits of your clay. And it doesn't matter how good you are, you still end up with a lot of stuff in your slot,
you know, okay. You're excited about. Some
inconsistency. Yeah, or things just don't. Yeah, sometimes things just don't work for you.
Okay.
You know, you push a little hard, or you know, your finger catches in a funny way or something, and that's the end of that one. Sorry. But it's all recyclable, so.
What are you currently working on?
I don't know.
Okay.
I was going to ask.
This?
Do you have any requests?
Can we give you something to me?
Sure, yeah.
Oh. I don't want to be greedy. I'd like someone to give us a desperate person.
Nobody's jumping up.
Maybe a mother talking.
Okay. Tall and skinny? Or short and wide? Or curvy?
Curvy sounds good.
Okay.
However you want to. Maybe a different kind of coffee mug. However you want to make it.
Okay.
So.
Hello, have you been pottery?
I started doing pottery 30 years ago. I'm terrible at art. I was always terrible at art. And I just did it for fun. And I was pretty terrible at pottery too, actually. But I didn't care. I just enjoyed it. And after doing it on and off for fun for about 20 years, I actually started to be able to make things.
So you said you were terrible at art.
Yes,
but obviously you're not.
At all. Okay. I appreciate art. I like to look at art.
Okay.
I just.
You're not terrible at pottery art.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. 2D art is not
okay,
my thing.
Okay, but 2D, like painting and drawing, was not your forte.
And even sculpture, I
don't
know, my brain just doesn't work out.
When did you first start to get an interest in art? Can you remember the age?
In high school.
High school.
Yeah, I always liked art. I took art history class in college, and I really enjoyed
it. Okay.
Appreciate.
And then
art. Wow.
Okay.
That's art.
Okay. Now, you like gardening before high school? Flowers, I would assume?
Yeah.
Okay. And, you know, I do see the connection between gardening, which is working in the soil, working, getting your hands dirty.
Mm-hmm.
Did you do some gardening before?
Yeah.
Okay. You've always enjoyed working.
Always enjoyed getting
dirty. Yeah, okay.
Yes.
Right. Do you make flower pots ever?
I do. I have made flower pots. Most people, making a flower pot takes a lot of clay, and it's not easy to throw one piece flower pot with the plant. I mean, I can do it, and I enjoy doing it. But nobody will buy it. Because nobody wants a $50 flower pot.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, it's it's a different kind of appreciation.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I can make them for myself as gifts. I don't.
Very nice ones. Yeah. Let me ask you again. Typically, when you go to, say, bake your, how do you say, fire?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Fire your pieces. How long did that process take? Between, you know, I don't know if you can just put them in the kiln right away or you have to leave them out.
They have to be bone dry before they go in there.
Okay.
If there's still any moisture in the clay, they'll explode.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
And I have pushed the process a little too hard, too fast, and had pretty much the whole kiln load of stuff explode.
Oh wow.
It's a real bummer inside. Very sad.
So
it has to be completely dry before you fire the first time. Then, and that takes anywhere from like 9 to 12 hours of firing, and then it takes maybe another 12 to 18 hours to cool down before you can take it out. And you take it out, you sand it, you wax the bottom, and you glaze it, and then you fire again. And this time, when I fire it the second time, it usually takes about 9 or 10 hours for the firing, and then I do a 5-hour slow cool. So it takes about 2 days until I can get it out again.
And how is your electric or gas bill?
My husband works for the electric company. So
no.
At least we don't feel bad when we have a high electric bill because at least we're in a burn.
So I do
use electric kiln. A lot of potters today use electric kilns.
And why so? I'm guessing because of the consistency, the evenness that it is, or?
Mostly, electric kilns are a lot easier to manage and they're less expensive.
Okay.
Gas kilns are, they're a lot bigger and heavier, and you have to worry about venting the gas and dealing with, I don't know, they're a little more complicated. The results of a gas firing can be more interesting because of the reduction of the oxygen in the air, and then the way that the fumes move around, it can really create interesting effects. But for now, people are developing, and pottery supply houses are developing glazes for electric kilns that allow you to get the same kind of amazing effects that you get in a gas kiln. So I mean, it's pretty easy to just plug in an electric kiln in your basement.
I read an article one time that they took a machine that would record sound, and they took these old vases from the Ming Dynasty, and they put them on a wheel, and those that were not glazed, the unglazed ones, they actually could hear this talking of the women that made the pottery.
Wow.
And acted like a record player for a recording.
Oh, wow.
So I always think that that's a really interesting outcome of something that's spinning like that, and to capture voices and sounds.
Yeah.
As it would be like a record, you know? So they were able to decipher some of the conversations that took place while the ancient women were making their large pots.
That is amazing. Now there are several different ways that you can make handles. And handles is another one of those things that you have to practice it and practice it and practice it and practice it. And it's just so much harder than looks when your teacher is showing you. But eventually, after you do a couple hundred or a thousand of them, you get better at it.
That's a What are you making right now?
Handle. You asked me for a mug?
Okay.
You gotta have a handle, right?
Yeah, I was thinking, wow, that's a...
That's a weird shape, right?
Yeah. Big piece of clay. I thought you said candle, I was like, candle? I thought she was making a candle. Yeah, kind of. I thought you actually said candle. I need to clean my ears out.
So now normally I would wait until this is drier and a little more in leather hard state so that it doesn't form so easily when I touch it. But since this is a demonstration, I'm just going to squish it. So, because this clay is very wet, I don't have to slip it through, but if it's dry, I would scratch here and scratch here and put a little water just to help it stick.
When I was a kid growing up in Jamaica, I used to make all kinds of things from mud. You just call it mud in general, clay. And getting one piece to attach to the other piece was always a little bit of a challenge.
You know,
get it to stick. Sometimes we'd actually drive little sticks through both pieces. Just to ensure that it wouldn't fall apart.
Yep.
But obviously we're not, you know, firing it or anything like that.
Right.
We're just making it air dry. Yeah. It brings me back. It takes me back to when I was a child.
Can you accelerate the drying process with fans?
Yes, you can. And there's a danger to that. So for small pieces, that are just a single piece, that's not such a problem. But if you have a large piece, or if you have pieces like this where there are two pieces stuck together, what happens is if you dry them fast, this dries quickly, it shrinks, pops right off the top. So and if you have a larger piece, and especially if the bottom is a little heavier or the center is heavier, the outside dries very quickly, and it shrinks, and
breaks.
So that's very hard.
Yeah.
And it does happen a lot. So it's better to dry it slowly, and a lot of times I will actually just put a little plastic over top, just loosely over top, to help them dry more slowly. I can force things to dry quicker, and I'm going to lose some, you know, like if I have an order and I have to get it by a certain date, I've done it. If I need one, I will make three or four, you know?
Well, that's drying it before you actually take it to the fire.
That's before you fire it, yeah. So now when I make handles, I just do a little... A lot of people ask about that, that's for sure. But there does seem to be a resurgence right now in handmade all kinds of things. And so I belong to a group of potters in the greater Lehigh Valley area, and we do a lot of workshops together. And potters are an interesting group of people because they're very eager to share all of their secrets. It's a very collegial group of people who are like, oh my gosh, I figured out this great way to use this tool, I have to tell you all about it. So people, they're very willing to share, and they're very friendly, and so there's there are very few things in this world that are more pleasant for me than like spending the weekend with a bunch of potters. Like that's for sure.
That's good to know. I like working in the soil, planting, doing things at my hands where. So, Virginia, while you're doing that, I'm going to introduce another artist.